no, not yet.
Oh, wow.
You're going to hear that. Just sit there and grin, okay? Pretend you're enjoying it. For a moment. Hi, everybody. I'm so glad you're here. That was that, the word desultory occurs. It was a desultory cry. Oh, you're cold. Okay, good. So, as the grand finale of this whole day, which started at 8 o'clock this morning, we thought, you know, maybe there's 200 people here. And apparently, two groups of, a total of about 30 VIPs who were supposed to be there, and the miscommunication, I'll do that. I'll take care of the 215 group of VIPs after I'm done talking to you guys here. So, what do we, how do we start? I have a book called Boldly Go coming out in the fall. And the book, it didn't start off, didn't have a central theme to start off, but it was like the diary, I guess. And I had a wonderful young writer shape it for me, but I would just talk for hours, and he recorded and shaped the book. But there was no overarching theme. It was just things that happened to me, and lessons I drew from it, or just for myself. I have no idea that anybody should listen to anything I say, except maybe for the adventure of somebody's lifetime. But there's no general thought that anybody can use it. Just my life. But what happened is I recorded the audio book as well, and they had slotted 3 days for it, and I did it in one day because I knew most of the words. I mean, I knew some, most of the thoughts, but the actual words I'd long since forgotten. But in the reading of the book, I felt the arc, and the arc is the thought, which is the basic one of the theories of the basic building blocks of the universe is vibration, so that everything vibrates and we vibrate, and there has to be, in my mind, a connection between what we are doing with our little electrochemical towers of our bodies and the vibration, and the vibration of the universe. And so I may be talking about a latter day, the term instead of vibration could be God, but to me, the science of what we're discovering it tells me another story, which is, and I'm not talking about who started it or any of those mysterious that we'll never know, or would seemingly we never know. But if the universe is vibrating and we get into it with, and we become part of that, in tune with that vibration through prayer or meditation, or just being aware of the theory of what I'm talking about, somehow, for me, the universe seems to take care of it, care of us, care of me. So this book starts off with the first album I made, which was called The Transformed Man. And Decca Records, it was a popular record at the time, said, would you like to make an album? No, I'm not going to make an album. And what's your theory? What's your theme? And I thought, well, I could do, because I'd been doing lyrics on talk shows, so there was a popular song, I could do the lyric because I was I was a classical actor, and I knew poetry, and I am the pentameter, and I had a feeling for poetry and the rhythm of poetry, the onomatopoeia of the words. And so I thought I could make an album which involved great pieces of literature, like, for example, to be or not to be. To be or not to be. That's the question. And link it with a man who's contemplating suicide to a song of the time. It was a very good year. It was a popular song at the time, and talks about he was 21 and he was 10, and it was a song affirming life. Another song was I linked it with Cyrano de Bergerac, who has a speech at the end which says, I made the last three lines was, I may climb to no great heights, but I will climb alone. And then the music underneath that segued into a drug song. Who can't stand alone? Needed drugs to, at least this was going on, what was going on in my mind. So there was the speech by Cyrano, and it segued into, I think the next song was Mr. Tambourine Man. And what is Mr. Tambourine Man? What does that mean? So in my mind, Mr. Tambourine Man was the drug dealer. Mr. Tambourine Man, I can't deal without the drugs. Mr. Tambourine Man! Cry of anguish in my mind. Okay. This is all me thinking. So now I go on, what's his name, The Night Show?
Johnny Carson.
Johnny Carson. So I go on Johnny Carson, the album, The Transformed Man was the name of the album. Go on Johnny Carson Show. And I got this, the album is dropping. Oh, really? Yeah, I'm good. And during rehearsal, the producer, Freddie de Cordova, was his producer. And I did the two cuts. And Freddie comes up to me and says, it's 6 minutes. You can only do 3 minutes. You can either do the speech or the Cyrano thing or do the song. I said, well, I might as well do the song. So out of context, the orchestra starts up, and I'm like, Mr. Tambourine Man! And I look over at Johnny Carson. He's going, oh. And that's what happened to the audience. Started laughing. What the fuck is that? And so the record kind of went into ignominy. I thought, wow, that's too bad, because I want to sing and I can't sing. I mean, I can sing, but I can't sing. The most beautiful thing that human beings do is singing, in my opinion. That the trained opera voice, that muscle that they work years on developing, and the notes, the high notes, the trills, it's incredible. That's where all our instrumentation has come from. It's all evolved from the human voice. And I admired and I'd envy it, and I want to do it, and I can't do it. But I have this feeling for poetry. So all these years, I thought I know how to combine it, I think. So, the album, 30 years later, is discovered by Ben Folds. Does anybody know when I say Ben Folds? Sure. So, thank you. So, for those who don't know, he's a great, when I met him so many years ago, great, one of the great young musicians. Now he's older, he looks exactly the same, and he's one of the great American musicians for, what would you say, avant-garde music? I mean, great ideas. So apparently, is the story he tells, he's at a garage sale. Now, what is the great musician doing at a garage sale? I don't know. But he sees my album, and I say, you know, when I tell the story, he says, my album was at a garage sale. But somebody wanted to get rid of it. And so they had it for sale, and there is this great musician comes by. Now, tell me, the universe isn't looking after me when this great musician picks up my album, plays it, loves it, and writes me. Now, he's a young man, and he writes me a letter saying, I'd like to work with you. And I get this letter, finally, arduously get the letter, and my kids are around, I'm reading the letter, dear Mr. Shatner, I'd like to work with you, Ben Folds. I said, do you know who Ben, and my kids are, do I know who Ben, Dad, oh my God, and they're overwhelmed with Ben Folds. So I said, well, okay, so I write him back, okay, I'd like, yeah, what do you suggest? He says, well, I'm making an album, and I've written a song for you. The album is called Fear of Pop. It was one of his big albums. And the song I wrote for you is White Oleander. And I finally recorded White Oleander. It was one of the hit songs on his album. Now I'm back singing. Okay? That was the beginning. Then I'm asked to do an album with Ben Folds. So we make an album called the Has Been. And Has Been is like three people, but still, that's three more people than wouldn't have, right? I mean, you got to count all three. So, but Has Been becomes a big hit, and there's some songs on there that were like, you know, it's terrific, which started me on a whole program of making albums for Cleopatra Records, and ultimately I ended up making a blues album, which went number one, and then I make a Christmas album, which went number one. I mean, it was just, right, so then we're asked, I'm having dinner with a guy by the name of Robert Chernow. So Robert Chernow is an executive, and we met, so I've forgotten how we met, but he's in New York, I'm in Los Angeles, and he comes to town, comes to Los Angeles every so often, and somehow, I don't remember how, we went to a Chinese meal at a particular restaurant on Fairfax Avenue. We went to a restaurant, and we ordered the duck. And the duck was really great. And he said, this is a great duck. And I said, yeah, it's great. And we have the buns and the duck, and we're eating the duck, and we're talking about everything. He's 40, 50 years old, and so he's a grown man, but younger than me, everybody's younger than me, and we're talking, it was great. And then he brings along a musician friend of his with whom he had gone to college. His name is Dan Miller. And Dan Miller, if I say they might be giants, does anybody know the group? Dan Miller is the leading light, and they might be giants. So Dan Miller and Robert Chernow and I are eating duck. And Dan says, we should make an album. And Robert says, let's put songs to some of Bill's adventures. And, okay, you know, I'm all right with that. And we begin, and COVID hits. And we now are communicating through, what do you call it? Zoom. Right through Zoom. So now the three of us, but especially Robert and I, so I tell Robert a story, like, well, here's one that might work as a song. I was, I graduated from university. I'd been doing theater all the time and radio and television in Montreal, and now I was headed, well, actually I was headed for Ottawa, but let's say I was headed for Toronto, the New York of Canada, to now start a career. And I'm crossing a bridge across the St. Lawrence River. I'm crossing a bridge. And coming at me is an 18-wheeler pushing that envelope of air that they have in front of them. And my father's loaned me $400 to buy a car. So I've got a $400 used Morris Minor car, which you can pick up the front bumper. I mean, it's so light. Now this envelope of air shoves this car almost over the side. And like, my God, everything I own is in the back seat. And if I go over, I never existed. I would never have existed. My parents were, oh God, we lost Bill. No, what's for dinner? You know, I mean, well, that's the way it is. That's life. Yeah, he died. How was that? He pushed over the bridge. The steak is raw, honey. It should be medium rare. I mean, that's the way life is. There's no legacy. What is legacy? Which is another story. So the song became, but I said to Robert Cherno, I said, but everybody is always crossing a bridge. And there's always an 18-wheeler coming at you. Every bridge you try and cross, there's always something coming at you. And that's the nature of the song called The Bridge, which is on the album Bill, which has got these breathtaking reviews that's now in whatever, however you buy it in the marketing world, is streaming or something like that. We wrote several songs for Bill, so many more songs for Bill than, because we were just enjoying the process of, I would tell the story, Robert and I would work up the lyrics, Dan would fashion a melodic line, and we got a phone call from Ben Folds. Now this is like 20 years later. Oh, hey, Ben, Bill, oh, Bill, Ben, how are you, man? I've been appointed artistic director at the Kennedy Center. Would you like to do an evening at the Kennedy? Well, I'd like to do an evening. And it was Earth Day, several months ahead, and it's going to be Earth Day. Have you got so many songs about Earth and about trees and things? Yeah, I end up at Kennedy Center with a half a dozen songs, a 70-piece orchestra, and all these the wonderful musicians at the National Symphony Orchestra, and there's an evening with me at the Kennedy Center on songs that I had really written material that I wrote in between the numbers, and it was a smash. People rose up and started applauding. It was like, and walked off and came back three times, back and forth. People screaming and yelling. We had to turn the lights on to get the 3,000 people out of that theater. It was a triumph of me doing the music. I'd gone from being laughed 30 years before, more, to having a musical triumph. And when I say, no, it's just, I'm thinking, how many coincidences, and in my opinion, there's no such thing as coincidence, how many things had to be in place to go from there to there? So that's the scan of the book, starting with that record and then many other stories of, God, I don't know how this happened, but that happened and this one, and then it ends with the concert at Kennedy Center, which, by the way, they didn't, they don't film, it wasn't on television, and they weren't going to make an album out of it. And I said, look, I'll put seven cameras on it, record it with fidelity, and I'll pay for it. And that's what I did. I paid for what will be a television show, presumably called Shatner Live at Kennedy Center or something like that, and an album of these great songs. One of the songs is I Want to Be a Tree. Funny, huh? So, do not, what am I going to say? You got it. Don't record the, it would be a violation of something or other. Don't record the song. Introduce yourself.
I'm Bill.
Bill.
That's Bill.
Brookaville. And he's a songwriter, an entertainer, and a pianist. And this is I Want to Be a Tree. Bill, you were wonderful. That's great. So, that's the book and the album and all that kind of thing, and the universe looking after me, and I presume that it's got to look after you. I was telling one of the people at the VIP thing, that cancer has entered my family. Not me, but a member of my family. And she's scared. And the doctor said it's going to be all right. It's going to be a rough year, but you won't die, which is a comfort to her, of course. And then the whole, so I've got 15 people in my immediate family, three girls and grandchildren and stuff like that, and guys that married the girls. And everybody expressed their love for her, and all the little minor squabbles and things they've had disappeared, and it was just pure love and empathy. And everybody was so moved by the onrush of emotion. And I said to her, one door closes, you're afraid of dying. Another door opens, and you see how meaningful the relationships you have with the people around you, the people, and what life has to offer. All of a sudden, this ugly cancer offers a rainbow of attention to life, and not to take life for granted, that every rustle of every leaf and every cloud that's graced with gold is part of the magic of our life. Everything here is beautiful. It's beautiful to take 5 billion years to evolve into this. It's beautiful. And the tragedy, of course, is that, you know, people are like, oh, it's hot. It's really 104 degrees in London. Never happened like that before. Yes. And it's not like one of those nightmares like, oh, we'll wake up and it'll be cool. No. It's going to get hotter and hotter unless we do something. Now, I've been interviewing. I have in the past interviewed a lot of people. One of them was a Nobel Prize winner, scientist, and guy who won it for 2021. And I said, I don't understand why all the governments of the world aren't doing, when I say Manhattan Project, you know what I mean? The atomic bomb during the Second World War gathered all these scientists to make an atomic bomb so we could win the war. And we won the war because and saved a million American soldiers from invading because the atomic bomb made the enemy give up. That was the Manhattan Project. Why the hell isn't there a Manhattan Project about carbon capture and methane and exactly why? I mean, no, everybody, well, no, well, but just it doesn't exist. My God, what do you need to be shown how these things are? I mean, there's a tsunami coming our way. San Diego, in a number of years, you won't see this. They'll be underwater. Miami. I mean, the cities of America, think about Bangladesh, which is 2 or 3 inches above the level of the sea. The sea is going to go 3, 4, 5, 6 feet high. I mean, it's a disaster looking at us. We've got to do something about it. When I went up into space, the Sunday before I went to the desert to go on Blue Horizon, I sat with Dan Miller and Robert Chouinard, and, you know, I'm going up there, guys, and we got to write a song about space. I said, yeah, let's make some notes, and we started writing what we thought would be the song about space. When I came down, one of the first phone calls I made was to the guys, and I said, you know everything we talked about on that Sunday evening about space? Forget about it. It has nothing to do with what I experienced. And so we wrote a song, which I did. I performed at Kennedy Center, called So Fragile, So Blue. And it was summed up the experience I had. And, you know, it was the diadem of the evening, and it spontaneously caused a really, I mean, I've done a lot of stage work and a lot of entertaining people on stage, written material on written material, and I've been very lucky that the reaction's been really good on tour with the one-man show I had on Broadway, standing ovations every time. I don't remember an evening that the people didn't stand and applaud all those times. So I was blown away by the reaction at Kennedy Center. What was I going to say? So going up into space, I was very fearful. Hindenburg came to mind. the gas they put in the Hindenburg hydrogen, it was the same gas they were putting in the rocket I was going to be in. And then I thought, oh, geez, there's the O-ring thing, you know, the O-ring thing, and the rubber pad, the Challenger. They were warned that the O-ring, the
seals?
The seal, but there was another, automobile engines have it, gasket, thank you. The rubber gasket that between the first and second stage had a rubber gasket, and the rubber wasn't trustworthy at 32 degrees, and it was 32 degrees that morning. And so they had this discussion between the engineers, shall we not? And then it is the opinion of people that the idea that we've got to schedule. And my vote is to go with the thing. And they went with a large number of people saying, don't go. A larger number of people said, go. They went, and the gasket leaked, and the hydrogen exploded, and we lost those beautiful people. And then I thought of is it mnemonic memory where you think of something else to think of something else? So okay, so the word I'm thinking of to think of the word I want to think of is trouble. The Hubble. Okay. Trouble with Hubble. I get to the trouble with Hubble, and I get to trouble, and I can't remember the word Hubble. And I don't know why I blocked in the word Hubble. So the Hubble telescope is another example of why I was fearful. So let's make the Hubble telescope, we'll name it, and we'll get it, and it'll be $4 billion, and we'll get England and Canada and the United States to make the Hubble. So the English are working on whatever it was they worked on, Canadians did, Americans did, and they put it all together, they sent it up, $4 billion to send up in space. And it doesn't work. They're looking at it, it's a little blurry. Why is it blurry? They discovered that the English used imperial measurements, metric, and Americans didn't. Now, how is it possible that you used metric? Oh, shit. That's bizarre. But what that means to me is human error. Everything is in human. Everything is possible. But human error. We're human beings. We make errors. Look at the errors we're making here about the three people, the four VIP groups, right? That's a human error. It happens a lot. So I'm thinking human errors. I'm sitting in the spaceship. Human error. And then they said, T-minus 17, T-minus 15, 14. Hold it. There's an anomaly. There's an anomaly in the gut. What the fuck is that? It's the truth. As the gantry was being pulled away, just before it was pulled away, there was an announcement in our loudspeaker while we're lying there waiting for the gas to explode. And the guy on the loudspeaker says, all right, we're going to pull the gantry away. If anybody wants to get off now, now's the time. That's God's truth. And I'm looking at this gantry pulling away thinking, I'm Captain Kirk. Shit, I can't go. So that's what I was thinking when I went up, and when I got up there and I looked out that window, I looked back at that window back there. I don't know why I was looking back, but I could see the wake of the spaceship making it through the blue air, like there was a submarine going through the water. It leaves a wake, and my God! And then I looked over here, and there was the blackness of space, and it was so black, it was deadly, it was death. Look back there, that's life. And then, I don't know what happened, but when I got down on the ground, I was crying, weeping, and uncontrollably. I heard myself say later on in the film, I don't want to ever forget what I'm feeling. And what I was feeling was this great grief. What the hell? And I'm sitting on a truck bench, and I'm wondering, why am I crying? And I realize I'm in mourning for our Earth. I was the grief of the dying of the Earth. So, upon further reflection, it took me some days. Here's the sum total, if you want to know what I was thinking. I was sitting in Cambridge Cathedral at Cambridge on my way to go interview Stephen Hawking. And I'm sitting alone. We'd been filming there. The place was empty. This giant cathedral, empty. And somebody was cleaning the organ notes. So they were playing notes, bum, 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 in this empty cathedral. And I'm sitting there in whatever the name is for that column that goes up with stained glass windows, and I'm looking up and I see a mote of dust caught in the sunlight. I just don't get there, my God. That's what Earth must look like. This twinkling thing, how small it is in this giant space. And I thought, when I came down, how insignificant. I could see Earth, I could see the curvature about like that. And I thought, my God, if I just continue the circumference, I could make a circle in with my arm that would encompass the whole Earth. That's how small it is. We're insignificant. We're in a mediocre sun and an insignificant planet. We, you know, we think, oh, the sun's going around the Earth. No, it doesn't. We are in the tail end of the Milky Way galaxy, an average galaxy among billions of galaxies, okay? And we're an average star, the sun, and we're a small speck of dust. We are a grain of sand in the Sahara Desert. And we humans are these insignificant things on the grain of sand. How insignificant is that? And I was overwhelmed by that thought. And then I had another thought, which was, but we're aware of how insignificant we are. We're aware of our insignificance. And still we marvel at the majesty of the universe and the complexity of our inability to understand. And the Einstein said, space is a spooky place. It's spooky. It's filled with laws and energies that we don't understand. Black matter is pushing the universe apart. It should be coming together with gravitational flow. We don't even know what gravitation. We know nothing. We know nothing. And yet, at the end of this documentary that they had made about me going up there, Jeff Bezos puts his arms around me. I thought, that's the other thing. Because I finally saw the tail end of that documentary. That's the other thing. There's love. We love. And that's the magic of our life. And that's my voyage into space. Thank you very much, everybody. Pleasure to talk to you.
VIPs that I missed, if you'll collect in that corner, we will try and make up.